If you're making any changes to the walls or floors in your home, even as small as a new door opening, even if you think they're completely non-load-bearing, you don't have to use an architect, but it is now a legal requirement to engage a structural engineer. If you ignore what I'm going to tell you, it will come back to bite you as and when it's time to sell the house, as the buyer surveyor picks it all apart. And in this video, I'll explain how to engage an engineer and how you can estimate what their fees might be in relation to your specific project. In order to make any change to your home, unless it is just like for like, in which case we would just class it as a repair. For example, it might be a kitchen or bathroom replacement, where you're just putting new units in to replace the existing. Maybe upgrading something like the insulation or re-roofing. You don't need a building warrant. A building warrant is just another word for a permission to build. You need permission from your council to build or alter anything within your home. That's just the way it is. Anything material that moves something from one place to another, knocks a hole in it, moves a sink, changes a door position. You cannot get a building warrant from your local council now without a structural certificate or evidence that all the calculations have been done for your new proposed building works. And I made a video about the building warrant process here that you should see and what to send your engineer to help him generate a fee. Now, I know these engineers' drawings can look a little bit complicated, but if you just spend a few moments actually reading through what's written, I promise you, you'll be rewarded as you realise it's all very easy to understand. I frequently go back to the engineer and challenge why they've done something, since as the owner of the project, or if I'm just the architect or builder, if I'm working in that capacity, I'll still have a working knowledge of the project design, and I'm always amazed at how often the engineers have overlooked or misunderstood something. And as many builders will often remind you, architects and engineers, they don't work in the real world, sitting behind their fancy desks. And whilst that may be a little bit true, they are highly experienced and educated in structures, whereas your friendly builder is usually clueless, despite their years of experience. I've made a few videos about that exact topic here, and you might find it a wee bit entertaining. Not to worry though, as you're looking over their draft engineering drawings, and yes, they should always produce a provisional set for comment as part of their fee to you, I'll have a marker pen to hand and scribble on where I see discrepancies and mistakes. I'll also suggest changes where I can see a more economical way of doing it. For example, rather than 145mm joists at say 400 centres, how about 170 joists at 600 centres, which is a lot less work on site since there's a lot less joists to fix if you've got the depth. If you're paying for materials, you'll immediately become far more forensic when looking over proposals, drawings and specifications from the people that you're employing, and it'll also help you think about sequencing and ease of construction for any new steelwork. I'll give you an example here. The engineer hadn't thought through how to physically get this big horizontal beam in to support the wall above with all the acro props in the way. Pretty much impossible to build, actually. I proposed a splice beam, did this sketch, a splice beam, so splitting it into three pieces. I sent them this sketch to the engineers. They said, okay, and came up with this amendment, which of course they couldn't really charge an extra for, since their original proposal couldn't actually be built. But, and it's a big but, I do all of this before I start the job. Sometimes the engineer will make the change, and sometimes they'll point something out to me that I wasn't aware of or I hadn't considered, and that's okay. I'm happy to learn. It's not a competition, it's a group effort where we work together to find the optimal solution in a time scale that works for everyone. If I'm not building it, I'll meet up with the builder to get his input, but again, will be before the job starts and while he's still pricing it. And back to our complaining builder, the reason things usually look over-engineered is because the person who is designing them has to design for a worst-case scenario, and that is just a result of the world that we live in today. That one in a thousand, one in a million occurrences that are very, very unlikely to happen to your own property. Don't blame the engineers, blame the lawyers and the dispute culture they promote. in order to get more fees. Blame the insurance companies, which won't explain their conditions to us as the builders and as the architects and engineers. They won't make it free of jargon, and it is impossible to decipher. Blame the homeowners and blame the builders, who are complicit in this culture, if we smell a buck or two where there's blame involved. But don't listen to builders who wait till after the job starts to tell you their ideas. Here are some typical structural engineers' fees and project types you're likely to come across for your own projects based on my experience. For this attic extension, we need an engineer to calculate the beams for all the new openings here, here and here, and calculate the existing joists are strong enough to take the increased weight of loadings of things like furniture and people. Here we're doubling them up. For this rear extension, we need the engineers to design our foundations, the steel beams to support the new openings, and the sizes of the floor joists, wall studs, and the rafters. For this house renovation, a staircase is being reorientated, and the joists and rafters need to be properly stiffened to take account of all of that. In this one, we're removing the wall to make an open plan kitchen and dining room. The floor joists above are sitting on the wall, and since the wall has been removed, the engineer has designed a flitch beam, which is a steel plate with timber both sides, to support those joists sitting above it. We're knocking a new window through this brick gable. The engineer has proposed a steel catneck lintel. Even for something as small as making a new opening in an odd load bearing wall, such as for this new utility room, we still need an engineer involved to confirm it's non-load bearing and provide documentation for our building warrant. Same here for this tenement refurbishment. And aside from these examples, costs for engineers' fees tend to be on the value of what they think the build will be, multiplied by a percentage. So in order to calculate their fees, we need an idea of what the build cost could be, and we'll base on any information we have so far. I made a whole video about this and how percentage fees work, and how you can estimate them for yourself using square meter estimates with some templates you can download from my website here. So with a very rough guesstimate, we can start to figure out how an engineer might calculate their fees, since thankfully they're in exactly the same guessing boat as us, most likely using the same guessing method as us to create their estimates. An approximate cost for an engineer's fee for this will depend on the overall structure as well as the foundations, but usually around 2-3% of the overall build cost might be about right for anything over about £50,000. The percentage comes from the Professional Institute, although each individual engineering company might decide to deviate, sometimes by offering a small discount, for example, and there'll probably be VAT on top to consider if you're in the UK. And here I'm taking our guesstimate for the build, multiplying it by the engineer's percentage to get the estimate for the fees. I do see homeowners and builders as well carrying out work to homes when they believe it to be non-load bearing without going through the hassle of getting a building warrant and engineer, and most every time it comes back to bite them. I know, because I get called in to do retrospective warrant applications at great cost to the homeowner, and usually there's a builder involved and getting into trouble as well. Your home insurance is dependent on all the insured elements within your house having the correct permissions, and you will quickly find out if you come to sell or remortgage your house that if your title deeds don't reflect what's actually built, if it's not like for like repair, then you'll need to apply retrospectively for building regulations and involve a structural engineer at that point. It costs more if you do it in that way. For my types of projects, small domestic builds that are a straightforward exercise for a firm of structural engineers, I'll look for small one-man practices where they are not over the VAT threshold. I don't want to pay that additional 20% of VAT when I don't need to, if it's for my jobs at least. If it's for your jobs, I'd suggest doing the same, but some recommendations involve someone who's already VAT registered. Please give me a like, it really does make a difference, and I hope to see you in the next one.